In 1825, New York City commissioned an American artist to paint a portrait of the Marquis de Lafayette. While he was working on the portrait in Washington, D.C., the artist received a letter summoning him home to Connecticut to his sick wife. By the time the artist arrived, his wife had died and had been buried before he could get there. The well-known painter was Samuel Morse, who had an interest in electricity and resolved to find a way to improve communications through the means of electricity. Almost 20 years later, in 1844, Morse celebrated the opening of the first telegraph line by sending a message from the capital to Baltimore. The message was taken from the Book of Numbers. "What hath God wrought?" In a recent issue of Smithsonian, the editor observes that at the turn of the 20th century, the Brooklyn Daily Eagle, a feisty newspaper once edited by Walt Whitman, published a special section peering into the next 100 years. The future then was a bright, hopeful world of possibility. Just think of it, mighty airships crisscrossing the skies, electric lights solving the problem of crime, the elimination of houseflies due to the disappearance of horse-drawn carriages, and the union of the telephone and the phonograph, bringing theater and opera right into the salon of one's own home. Professor Reidenberg has demonstrated that we too are on the edge of technology, that in our youth we could scarcely have imagined. So as our first panel explored the relationship between the private sector and the amassing of information that we have long regarded as personal and private, our next panel will explore a similar question, though through the framework of what the government knows about us from the digital world and what it can or cannot, should or should not do with those ones and zeros. We have reason to be concerned. In a recent speech, CIA Director David Petraeus warned us of the utter transparency of the digital world and observed that data is created constantly, often unknowingly and without permission. Every byte left behind reveals information about location, habits, and by extrapolation, intent and probable behavior. The number of data points that can be collected is virtually limitless, presenting enormous intelligence opportunities. Indeed. If we as moderns are not as confident as Samuel Morse that God should be either credited or blamed for our own technological marvels, we are at least entitled to ask, what hath Steve Jobs wrought? We have a superbly qualified panel. I will not repeat their biographical details, which are found in your program, but we welcome our moderator, prolific author and law professor Jeffrey Rosen. His panelists are Professor Tino Cuellar of Stanford Law School, Marcia Hofmann, Senior Staff Attorney at the Electronic Frontier Foundation, and Professor Orin Kerr of George Washington University Law School. Please welcome our panel, and Professor Rosen, the time is yours.
Thank you so much, Judge Bybee. I have to begin by thanking you and your colleague, Judge Anna Brown of Portland, Oregon. Both of you, Jay and Anna, have done such a superb job of organizing this panel and bringing us to Hawaii, and we are so honored and grateful to be here. Yesterday, while we were talking among ourselves in preparation for the panel, we reflected on the title of our discussion today, Tracking and the Government, Should We Be Concerned? And the panelists agreed that if the government continues to invite us to conferences like this, you can track us as much as you like, and we won't be concerned in the least. The previous panel did a wonderful job in discussing the issues raised by private sector surveillance and getting our attention. They've set a high bar, and we will hope to continue the conversation by talking about government tracking. One thing that is striking about this remarkably rich area about translating the Constitution into an age of new technologies is how open almost all of the interesting questions are. The Supreme Court just last year, as Kathleen Sullivan discussed yesterday, decided one of the most important Fourth Amendment cases of the past decade and held in U.S. v. Jones that the government cannot track a suspect without a valid warrant for an extended period of time when there is some physical trespass involved without that presumptively being a search. But what's so striking about that decision, although it gives us a vision into the way the court might approach these issues in the future, is how little guidance it gives to all of the issues involving geolocational surveillance and visual surveillance that are on the immediate horizon, that are being debated in the courts as we speak, and also in the near and distant future. So we are gonna treat this panel like a cross between a dinner party and the Charlie Rose show. and I'm going to throw out a series of hypotheticals and not so hypotheticals about actual examples of government surveillance that are being discussed at the moment and in the near future, and the panelists will respond not only by describing the existing law, so we all have a sense of what its constraints are, but also in speculating about what the law should be or how judges might address these sort of issues in the future, given the open-endedness of the legal materials. We're going to begin with GPS and locational tracking, and I want to share with you a hypothetical that is increasingly not so hypothetical that I first confronted in 2007 when I went to a conference about the future of privacy at Google. And this was a time when I first had the privilege of meeting Nicole Wong, who did such a great job on the previous panel, and her colleague, her then colleague, Andrew McLaughlin, who was head of Google's public policy operation, said he imagined that in just a few years, Google and Facebook and other social networking sites will be asked to put live and online all of the public and private surveillance cameras that now blanket the globe. So there are private sector cameras in shopping malls, and there are public cameras owned by the government, and these will be supplemented by photos from drones which are flying in the air and blanket the earth. And if Google agreed, in fact, to unite and put online these feeds and archive and store them, then it would be possible, Andrew McLaughlin suggested, to click on a picture of anyone anywhere in the world, say me here in Hawaii, back-click on me to see where I came from this morning, forward-click on me to see where I'm going this afternoon, and basically have the possibility of 24/7 surveillance of anyone at any time in the world. And McLaughlin posed a stark question, which was then hypothetical and is now less so. First, should Google do this? And second, would it be legal? Would it violate the Constitution? Would it violate other legal norms? What is so striking, first of all, 5 years later or so, is that McLaughlin's reality is already taking place. Facebook recently introduced an app that allows you to sign on to pictures of live beach cameras in Mexico, which are popular with teenage boys for reasons you can imagine. But Facebook is, the prospect of these apps being united and put live is no longer so remote. So let's imagine Google did this and gave it a fancy name, say it called it Open Planet, and it might be a cool new app. Check up on your friends and see what they're doing and sign on and track someone anywhere in the globe. Would this violate the Fourth Amendment to the Constitution, which says the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects shall not be violated? Well, the first problem, as you instantly intuit, is that Google's not the government. A private corporation, not regulated necessarily by the Fourth Amendment at all, perhaps the Fourth Amendment doesn't apply. All right, well, let's assume that the government is using this open planet system to track suspected terrorists, and we take care of the state action problem. Then, is it a search under the Jones case? Well, the majority in Jones said there had to be a physical trespass. You had to physically affix the device to the bottom of the car. Here, no trespass at all. The drone cameras are doing their live feeds, and you don't have to invade anyone's property interest. All right, well, the concurrence in Jones said maybe long-term surveillance that revealed a lot of information that we expect to be private might be a Fourth Amendment search, even without a physical trespass. Yes, but that depends on the fact that we don't expect it to be public. And if Google just announced tomorrow, we're going to unite these cameras, and maybe that's after a few years of more and more of these apps going live, then even according to the concurrence, our expectations of privacy might be diminished in a way that eliminate constitutional protections. And then there's the problem, the fact that we've voluntarily surrendered this data to Google when we walk out in public, and according to some legal doctrines, which our panelists will discuss, the third-party doctrine, we no longer have an expectation of privacy in data that we've voluntarily surrendered to third parties. So those are just four reasons why it's not obvious that even the open planet system, which makes possible a degree of surveillance far greater than the framers of the Constitution feared when they passed the Fourth Amendment to prevent King George's minions from rummaging in the desk drawers of critics of the king, even a violation like this might not violate current case law as it's understood. I'm going to ask each of our panelists to set the stage by reflecting about these holes in Fourth Amendment doctrine. Why is it that we don't have a clear answer to the question of what kind of virtual surveillance is or isn't permissible? And then we'll dig down a little deeper. And I'm going to ask Orin Kerr to begin.
Thanks, Jeff. A pleasure to be here. What makes this panel different from the earlier panel, of course, is that now we have the public interest in the government's ability to collect evidence and bring criminal prosecutions and solve crimes, which is going to be balanced against the public's interest in privacy. And that balance, I think, really needs to frame all of our answers to these sorts of questions. What makes the questions different and hard is that we're dealing with new facts. So we're all pretty comfortable and familiar with the idea of government surveillance in the physical world. It might be a police officer walking down a public street, looking around, seeing if there's something unusual. We understand what the rules should be, and the Supreme Court has given us a pretty good idea of what the rules are in terms of regulating government surveillance practices, searches and seizures in that physical world. And so some things the government can do that are not at all regulated by the Fourth Amendment, walking down a public street, for example, no Fourth Amendment issue, walking on open fields, no Fourth Amendment issues. On the other hand, if the government wants to detain somebody, there's a reasonable suspicion requirement. If the government wants to search a car, there's a probable cause requirement. If the government wants to enter a home, there's typically a warrant requirement. And we have those physical rules, and it's easy, I think, for judges to get a sense of the significance of the rules because we're all comfortable with physical surveillance and what it means. We get what an officer can observe. We get what it means to stop a person. We're sort of familiar with what this means. What makes all these technological issues difficult is that the technologies are changing and they're new. So it's very hard for us to get a sense of what is the significance of a particular legal rule. How much does a new technology, whether an actual new technology or a hypothetical new technology, really change the balance between the public interest in the solving of crimes and the public interest in privacy? And so all of these issues, I think, are difficult because they're new. We don't have a sense of, you know, how this app might work. Or take the case of GPS surveillance. You could see in the Jones case, the justices trying to figure out how invasive is GPS surveillance? Or to pick another example from the internet setting, there are different kinds of internet surveillance that the government can conduct. Typically, the dividing line in the legal rules, both of the statutory matter and increasingly as a constitutional matter, is the division between non-content information and content information. That may not be an intuitively obvious distinction, but you can sort of think about an email that you send is going to have the actual letter, the content of the communication. You're telling a friend, I'll meet you at, for lunch at 12:30. Or if you're engaged, some of you in this room, who knows, engage in a drug transaction, I'll bring you the drugs at 12:30. In that case, that's the contents of the communication, but there's a lot of information about the communication which is a non-content. When was the communication sent? To whom was it addressed? This is sort of envelope information. Maybe the rough analogy is to what used to be or what is on the outside of the envelope of a letter that might be analogy to the email. And what makes all of these technological questions different and difficult is that we're not really used to how the technology works, what the implications are. And I think some of you may remember a 1982 movie called Tron, a Jeff Bridges movie, in which Jeff Bridges is a computer hacker and he gets sucked into the computer and starts running around the circuitry with a funny hat on. That's not what government surveillance looks like. That's not what surveillance is like. You don't jump into the computer. It's a network, and there are servers, and there are ways of communicating, cables that are carrying the traffic, and the government is installing surveillance devices at various points in the network and then filtering that data to get different kinds of communication. So the facts are really different, and I think the first thing we have to keep in mind whenever we answer these sorts of questions is to understand exactly what are the technological facts here. It's very easy to just say there's a surveillance going on or the government is watching, but those are sort of a physical world concepts, and we need to make sure that when we address them in the context of new technologies, we're pretty specific as to what the technologies are, what their capabilities are, and exactly how they're working. So I think we do need to be specific in that way, and there are two general shifts that go on, I think, when we do make this sort of move to new technologies, and in particular a move to network technologies. A lot of the issues that we're going to be talking about are involving the internet, computer networks, and networks are different because we usually don't go to where we used to travel in the physical world. Instead, the network works by bringing communications to us. And so that means there's information that's being brought to us, and the surveillance is occurring by monitoring the information that's being transferred among individuals or from machines to individuals, rather than watching individuals out in public. So we've got a whole new set of facts that are implicated by that, and we need to think about sort of what changes. And I think two basic things change. One thing that changes is there's increasing reliance on statutes. So in the physical world surveillance setting, we really focus on the Fourth Amendment, and that's cases where the government itself is going out into the world and observing, maybe on a city street, maybe by searching a car. The government is acting directly. In the network setting, usually the government is acting indirectly. It's working through some third-party provider, Google, Yahoo, whatever the provider is, and saying, help me get the information. We don't want the government's agents to go knock on the door of Google and say, all right, we're going to take care of this. Give us your network. We'll look around. We want the third-party providers to be able to get the information more surgically and give it to the government. And that means that we need statutes that regulate that relationship between the providers and the government, that provide privacy rights in limiting what the government can do, and that also give the network providers some assurance that they're not going to get sued by complying with the government's request or court order. And in fact, we have a lot of these statutes. So a lot of the issues end up being statutory questions, which we're used to sort of thinking intuitively about the Constitution. And instead, there's a lot of statutory emphasis in this kind of network surveillance space. So that's one big change. And then the other change is sort of trying to figure out, how should the Fourth Amendment apply in these networked environments? And it puts a lot of strain on a bunch of doctrines that the courts have seen primarily in the context of telephone wiretapping. So in the sort of network communications world, you can think of the postal network as the first big network that the courts struggled with. And then you have the telephone network, and now it's the internet. And you can see sort of the evolution of the case law trying to grapple with what should be protected and what should not be protected. And what makes it hard is that now in the internet world, there's so much more going on. The internet is not just a way of A talking to B, it's a way of A doing everything. It's sort of recreating their offline world online. So there's just a lot more data to think about what should be protected and what shouldn't be protected.
Thank you so much. Tino.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak to you. It's great to be able to talk to the federal judiciary. It's even better to be able to do that without having to worry about being sanctioned or about being remanded to custody. And I should also add that when Jeff talked about how this is going to be a little bit between Charlie Rose and the dinner party, I prefer the dinner party. GPS, cell tracking, cyber detection, drone surveillance, network cameras. Orin has emphasized how these questions raise new issues. I want to agree and disagree a little bit. I want to focus on what is rather consistent with a set of historical dilemmas we have been facing as a society and as a country for 100 years or longer. And of course, there are elements of this that are new, but I think it's important in this conversation to remember what is not so new. Imagine a police officer weighing whether to search a building. How does she know whether to request a warrant? How should we gather sufficient information to enable the authorities to determine whether a particular target merits further attention? Although there are distinctions in how this question arises in criminal justice relative to intelligence or regulation, for my purposes, I think that it's more important to focus on what is similar here. In all of these contexts, the fundamental issue is whether this agent, whether she's an FBI agent who did great at Quantico or a new recruit into the San Jose Police Department, can be trusted. But that trust question has two components. One component is the question of whether you can trust her to be decent and fair, to have integrity, to treat people around her fairly. The other trust question is how much you can trust her intuition. How much you can trust her to be free of unconscious bias, how much you can trust her to aggregate information in a way that makes sense, or whether you'd like to live in a world where her intuition is supplemented by a computer, by an algorithm that sees patterns that she might not be able to detect. So when we think about that dilemma, I simply want to make 5 points that I hope you'll keep in mind during our conversation. Number one, this dilemma is not entirely new. Changes in how our society enforces laws and what the proper role is for the courts are part of a long-term trend at work here, from private prosecutions that used to be undertaken in court by victims, to the rise of police forces, to a world of investigation and analysis. Remember that police forces were created. They didn't exist before, but they were created about 100 years ago because some offenses required further investigation. The trend on how we write and enforce laws is away from the idea that most offenses are either readily observable or soon reported by victims, and towards a world where investigation, undercover operations, regulatory and intelligence activities use information technology to help manage a world full of risk. Let me give you an analogy that you might not expect from the world of food safety. How many of you have eaten beef, pork, or poultry in the past week? Many of you. You might be surprised to know that up until pretty recently, the way the U.S. Department of Agriculture tried to assure that the meat that you ate was safe was by seeing it go by on a processing line, looking for physical defects in the meat. Now, fortunately for you and for me, that's not the way the USDA approaches this issue anymore. Today, the USDA's work isn't primarily about visual inspection. It's about detecting E. coli 0157H7 and similar pathogens. It's about gathering data about the way food establishments operate, about pathogen concentrations, about critical control points, industry plans, and operational details. That's the trend that we've seen in policing over 100 years. Now, let's be clear. Government does not know everything about you, even if Google probably does. Sorry, Nicole. Compare international travel data, which the government has tremendous access to, with financial data, where the government has less access, to health information, where the government has even less access. But change is coming, and over time, large entities, whether in the public sector or the private sector, will know more and more about what the public does. Second, the public, and not just policymakers themselves, are driving these changes. They, or I should say we, are doing so because we want less risk and we have a sufficiently flexible constitutional structure. We want safer food. We want less risk of terrorist attacks. We prefer less public corruption. We want perpetrators brought to justice effectively, all of which implies a government that investigates and probably one that gathers and analyzes data in order to perform all these functions. Third, to echo Orin, in the modern world, information is protected, at least in the government context, almost entirely through statutory and, to a lesser extent, administrative means. At least since the Katz decision, the Fourth Amendment is implemented through a very open-ended standard that leaves much leeway for authorities, let's be honest. And because of the third-party doctrine that I know will be discussed in more detail later on, there's virtually no constitutional protection of information held or generated by the third parties through which you live your life, like a bank or an internet service provider, even though Americans often assume that all this information is private. So the bulk of the action is in how statutes are written and implemented. Fourth, the resulting statutory provisions have historically pivoted on a host of distinctions, such as treating separately intelligence and criminal investigation, or government-held and private sector-held information. Because of changes in technology, economics, law, and society, and this is where I agree with Orin, those distinctions are under increasing pressure. Think about the Patriot Act. It blurs the distinction between intelligence and conventional law enforcement information through changes in the FISA law. And if Google has records about nearly every aspect of your life, and under the Patriot Act, federal authorities can in certain circumstances easily obtain business records under Section 215 of the Patriot Act, then government can have much of the otherwise Google-owned data as well. Fifth and finally, we have an accountability challenge here, perhaps even more so than a privacy problem. If information is to be in the hands of large institutions, how can they be accountable? The record here is pointedly mixed. We know, for example, of hundreds of misused national security letters, thanks to a hard-hitting report from Justice Inspector General Glenn Fine. We know some of that misuse involved government requests for information that it was plainly not entitled to have under law. Judicial remedies sometimes exist, but they are subject to stark statutory limits plus constitutional standing concerns. Difficult though it is to resolve these problems, in all likelihood it is more difficult still to stop information from flowing to large institutions eager to analyze it, and that's the challenge before us. To summarize, the dilemmas we face are not entirely new. Second, the public is driving these changes in what information government gathers and how it's used. Third, in the modern world, information protection is almost entirely statutory. Fourth, the statutory distinctions that exist between intelligence and criminal justice, domestic and international, private and public, are collapsing. And fifth, we have an accountability challenge here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tino. Marcia.
Good morning. Thank you, Jeff, and thank you all for giving me the opportunity to speak here today. It's a real honor. I want to talk a little bit about this topic that's already been mentioned a couple of times, the so-called third-party doctrine. In United States versus Jones, the majority held that the physical installation of a GPS tracking device on a vehicle in and of itself is a Fourth Amendment search. And as a result, the court didn't need to reach the question of whether the prolonged tracking of that individual through that device in and of itself, independent of the physical trespass, itself might be a search. The majority opinion made clear that that was a possibility, but the court didn't need to reach it. Now, Justice Alito's concurring opinion, joined by Justices Breyer, Kagan, and Ginsburg, made clear that in their opinion, that sort of tracking, independent of a physical trespass, would, in fact, under certain circumstances, violate the Fourth Amendment. And Justice Sotomayor, in her own independent concurrence, made clear that she believed that that was a possibility as well. So I think it's clear that the entire Supreme Court believes that under certain circumstances, it's possible that the prolonged tracking of one's location without a warrant might violate the Fourth Amendment. Now, the big question for people like us who study privacy is one that we've been thinking about for years. How does the third-party doctrine affect this? Now, the third-party doctrine is basically the idea that if you convey information voluntarily to a third party, you no longer retain a reasonable expectation of privacy in that information. And this comes from two cases from the Supreme Court decided in the 70s. The first is United States versus Miller. The second is Smith versus Maryland. The Miller case involved a question of whether disclosing information to your bank about your financial transactions is something that is protected by the Fourth Amendment. And Smith versus Maryland involved the question of whether disclosing telephone numbers that you dial to your phone company is something that is protected by the Fourth Amendment. And in both cases, the Supreme Court said no. The Supreme Court said that when you convey information voluntarily to a company and they collect this information in the normal course of business, then you basically assume the risk that they might disclose that information to law enforcement. And so in that sort of situation, you don't have any Fourth Amendment protection. So this is something that is really coming to a head right now when we talk about digital information, because the fact of the matter is it's not possible to use the internet without disclosing information to service providers. It's not possible to use your cell phone without disclosing information to third-party service providers. And it presents this difficult question. Does this mean, effectively, that there may not be any Fourth Amendment protection for anything that you do on the internet? There are a couple of cases that have come up very, very recently that have directly addressed this question. One is a case in which my organization is involved. It relates to the criminal investigation into WikiLeaks that's going on right now in the Eastern District of Virginia. And in the course of that investigation, the Department of Justice has sought information from Twitter about several subscribers that apparently the Justice Department believes are linked to this investigation. We represent one of them. Her name is Brigitte Jonsdottir. She is a member of the Icelandic Parliament. So the Department of Justice sought information about these Twitter subscribers. They didn't get a warrant for it. On its face, the order appeared to seek only non-content information. As Orin described earlier, there are different protections here for content and non-content on a statutory basis. But this directly raised the question of whether or not the Fourth Amendment would protect information that you disclose to a service provider that is non-content. And in this particular situation, the information at issue are IP addresses. IP addresses are the numbers that are assigned to each computer that's connected to the internet that makes it possible to route data from one computer to another. So an IP address is sort of roughly analogous to, say, a street address. The thing that concerned our client about this situation is that the Department of Justice was seeking IP addresses over a period of 13 months. And so what would be effectively disclosed here are the IP addresses of all the computers that she was using to connect to Twitter over the period of 13 months. So that could reveal her computer usage in her home, in her office. If she has a mobile phone that she uses to connect to Twitter, you could see that she's using the mobile phone to conduct her expressive activities. And so we made the argument that the Fourth Amendment protected her greater interest in revealing her location over time and having the government collect that information. And the court disagreed with us and said, among other things, if you use the internet, you convey information to others so that you can route your communications. And under Miller and Smith, you have no reasonable expectation of privacy in that information. That's a pretty big sweeping statement. There was another case recently in New York State, People versus Harris, involved an individual who was charged with disorderly conduct for walking on a bridge during an Occupy Wall Street protest. And he was arrested and charged with disorderly conduct. And the government sought, the police sought 3 months of his Twitter activity in the course of preparing the charges. And that request included not only non-content information, but content information, public tweets that anybody could read on the internet, but also what are known as direct messages, which are sort of the equivalent of email. They're just private messages between Twitter users that not everybody can see. And citing the precedent in Virginia, the court in New York has found that because of the third-party doctrine, there's no reasonable expectation of privacy in that information. And so now this is leaking over into situations involving actual content. And this directs, this conflicts fairly directly with a case called United States versus Warshak, decided by the Sixth Circuit a couple of years ago, in which the Sixth Circuit found that you do maintain a reasonable expectation of privacy in email that you store or you route through a third-party provider. And the court there said, we don't think the third-party doctrine controls here. What we think is that this is analogous to a situation where you're staying in a hotel, for example. You maintain a reasonable expectation of privacy in your hotel room, despite the fact that hotel employees may come in for cleaning purposes or what have you. Or this is analogous to your protection in your mail. You may use the postal service to send messages, and you don't expect that your postal carrier is going to rip open your mail and read what's inside. It's reasonable to expect that that's private. And that's what this is more akin to. And I think that that is a very positive direction to be moving in, as opposed to the direction where the third party doctrine could effectively eviscerate any constitutional protections that we might have in anything we put online. And yeah, I think it's worth thinking about for all of you in the room. I mean, do you have a reasonable expectation of privacy? Do you have a subjective expectation of privacy in the email that you send? Do you have a subjective expectation of privacy in the documents that you might send to your colleagues? I mean, you have to use service providers in order to actually conduct those communications. And if basically the fact that you have disclosed that information to somebody who could possibly look at it, whether or not they actually do or represent that they will, it's a very important question. In her concurring opinion in Jones, Justice Sotomayor very specifically called out the third-party doctrine and said, I think it's time to rethink this in light of what we're seeing happening online. And I think that that's exactly right. And in terms of trying to figure out how to reconcile what we're doing online these days with the third-party doctrine, I think it's worth revisiting Justice Brennan's concurring opinion in United States versus Miller, where he says that the expectation of confidentiality between the person disclosing the information and the recipient of that information should be a factor that weighs into whether or not somebody has a reasonable expectation of privacy in something. You may disclose information to somebody with the understanding or the belief that is totally reasonable that they're not going to pass that information along to somebody else, including, for example, the government. And I think that increasingly we see some of the major service providers out there say in their terms of service or their privacy policies or their law enforcement guidelines that they will disclose information to law enforcement upon valid legal process, but otherwise they don't. And I think that that is something that might weigh in favor of somebody having a reasonable expectation of privacy, that their content data and perhaps other types of data won't be disclosed to law enforcement absent a warrant. I hope that more companies move in that direction. Another factor that might be worth taking into consideration when trying to decide whether somebody has a reasonable expectation of privacy is some of the emerging research that's coming out about what people actually believe or know about what's going on online and about how the internet works, how technologies work, and how they actually how technologies collect and process information. I think that that's stuff that's all worth looking at, and for a court considering these questions, they are factors that might weigh in to the conclusion of whether somebody has a reasonable expectation of privacy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So, Orantino and Marcia have done a great job at explaining to us why it is that the Fourth Amendment, as currently construed, is inadequate to protect things like geolocational data or the emails and private diaries that we turn over to third parties that used to be protected before the internet age. And Marcia cites Justice Sotomayor's call for a re-examination of the third-party doctrine, which says that when we turn over information to a third party for one purpose, we've abandoned all expectation of privacy in it for another purpose. I want to drill down on what exactly the alternative to the third-party doctrine would look like by citing the next phase of Jones, which is now percolating in lower courts across the country, and that is the question of cell phone data and geolocational data obtained from cell phone companies. In his concurrence in Jones, Justice Alito noted, Justice Scalia's focus on physical trespass is a completely Pyrrhic victory for privacy because the cops could have obtained the same geolocational information not by physically affixing a device to the bottom of the car, but merely by subpoenaing locational information from cell phone companies. And I gather from Orin, who is the nation's leading commentator on getting these opinions out quickly and telling us what to think about them, that the Sixth Circuit, just this morning, let no one say that you're not getting the most up-to-date information possible, decided a cell phone case and found that there was no expectation of privacy in the data. So why don't I first ask Orin to explain what the Sixth Circuit held and what you think about the reasoning.
Sure. So this is a case called United States versus Skinner, involving a bunch of individuals that were traveling across the United States with 1,100 pounds of marijuana in the back of their motorhome, and they were using prepaid burner telephones. It turns out the government actually figured out what the phone number was through some wiretaps of some co-conspirators, and were able to ping the telephone to determine its location over time, over 3 days. And so the government was able to find out that the motorhome was stopped at a rest stop outside of Abilene, Texas, and then they walked up to the motorhome with a drug-sniffing dog. The drug-sniffing dog, use of that dog is not a search under Illinois versus Caballos. So they used the dog alerted, and then they, based on the alert, searched the motorhome and found the 1,100 pounds of marijuana, leading to arrests. The defendant claimed that the use of the a court order, this is a statutory court order that the government obtained in order to get this information from the cell provider. The defendant argued that the court order was insufficient and that a warrant was required based on probable cause in order to get the cell site location, in order to ping the cell phone to determine its location. And the Sixth Circuit said that that was not a search, relying heavily on the third party doctrine, although the opinion among us is not exactly a model of clarity. It has several different rationales, and the facts are kind of left a little vague. But the gist of the opinion is that cell site information is not protected. It was a 2-1 decision with one judge saying that society is now prepared to recognize as reasonable GPS cell site information generally. Not a lot of reasoning as to why, but that was at least the conclusion of that. So that's a decision this morning, and clearly the scope of the third-party doctrine is a tremendously important question in any communications network, because networks work by disclosing information. I tend to think that the issue is not so much should the third-party doctrine be retained. I think the issue is sort of how far should it extend. So there are lots and lots of scenarios where pretty much everybody agrees the third-party doctrine should apply. One of them might be undercover agents. Going back to a case called United States versus Hoffa, Supreme Court case from 1966, the government is trying to catch Jimmy Hoffa involved in criminal activity. So they have an undercover, I guess it was a former friend of Hoffa's who agreed to work for the government, agreed to work for Bobby Kennedy, and figure out all the information that Jimmy Hoffa was telling all of his friends about his criminal activity. Supreme Court says you don't have a reasonable expectation of privacy, that your friends are truly your friends. It's not a search just because you happen to tell someone that you were engaged in crime. That's your problem if you disclose that information to a third party, like the person you thought was your friend is actually working for the government. And I think most people say, okay, that makes sense. It shouldn't be that the government needs a warrant in order to use an undercover. That's something that's regulated by entrapment doctrine, not the Fourth Amendment. On the other hand, you get these more controversial cases. The most controversial would be access to content information, and I agree that the third-party doctrine should not extend to the contents of communications, because in that case, the third party, the network provider, is merely an intermediary. It just so happens that the communication is routed to them. It's not sent to them. So I would draw a distinction between communications where you're sending a communication to that person, in which case I think the third party doctrine does apply. The government can go to that person and say, what information did that individual reveal to you? And just a mere intermediary. And what makes the cell phone, cell site information really tricky is this question. So I think of it as the black box problem. How many of you know that when your cell phone is on, it is communicating with your cell provider and giving location information to the cell provider? Well, the answer to that question, I'm not gonna have you raise your hand because you're all gonna have to go, oh yeah, I knew that. But what's happened over time, I've asked this question, 5 years ago, nobody knew that. People were astonished. Like, my cell phone is giving out my location information? That I'm outraged, it must cease. Well, it can't cease because the cell phone provider needs to know where you are. Today, more and more people know that that's how the technology works. So the black box problem is, do you treat cell phones like a black box, sort of a magic thing, and say you assume people don't know how it works, and therefore perhaps it violates a reasonable expectation of privacy, even if the reasonable expectation of privacy is premised on ignorance? Or do you assume that people know how technologies work? And assume that a reasonable person has an understanding of how that this is how cell phones work, therefore people know that their cell phones are broadcasting the information to the third parties. And effectively, the Sixth Circuit decision took the view that people know how these technologies work. You can't say somebody's incorrect understanding of a technology creates Fourth Amendment rights.
But why should it matter whether people know how the technology works? That's making the Fourth Amendment protections entirely dependent on how much we know that our privacy is being invaded. So, Marcia, you said the third-party doctrine should take seriously, you know, whether we read the terms of service of the cell phone and have a sense that the cell phone company could disclose it. But that leaves us with far less privacy in the age of cell phones than people had took for granted in the age of the framers. Why shouldn't the question be, as Justice Sotomayor suggested, that whether we know it or not, it's an invasion to be tracked 24/7 for a month, because that can reveal so much about us. And cell phone companies shouldn't be able to defeat that merely by telling us that they're planning to invade us.
No, I think you're exactly right. And I don't mean to suggest that I think the terms of service should absolutely control. I think it is a factor that a court ought to take into account. But I actually think it's not a good idea to model Fourth Amendment protections around very specific technologies and how they work and how people understand that they work, because technology changes so quickly. How many of you in the room have an iPhone? Okay, the iPhone first was introduced to the market in 2007. We've had them like 5 years. And in legal time, that's a very short amount of time. How many of you have an iPad? Okay, those have been around for 2 years. There aren't cases that address this yet. And, you know, If we had a case crop up tomorrow that very specifically raised questions about your expectation of privacy in, you know, your location as tracked by your iPad, by the time that actually became a good solid precedent, we'd be so far beyond that technology that it probably wouldn't make a whole lot of sense anymore. You know, the location technology and the technical sophistication of these products just get better and better and better all the time. And so I actually think that a better way to try to frame this is not in terms of your reasonable expectation of privacy vis-a-vis particular technologies, but rather trying to define what the societal interests are that we're trying to protect and make sure that we kind of hew to that.
So on that score, can I just jump in a little? I'm gonna channel Article 1 of the Constitution for a second and say, what's interesting here is the interplay of judicial decisions and statutes. I'm probably not alone in thinking that there's always been a tension between Katz and the line of cases that involve Smith versus Maryland and Miller. I mean, how do you reconcile exactly this exaltation of a reasonable expectation of privacy with the idea that, well, notwithstanding that you think your financial information is private, you actually don't have a constitutionally protected privacy interest in it? And that's a very uncomfortable fit, and as a very pragmatic matter, I don't think that's gonna change. So I think that we're right here to note that the changes at the constitutional level will be incremental. But it's very instructive to see what happened in the United States after the Miller decision came down, right? So it was not lost on everybody, and particularly not lost on folks sitting in Congress. This was an issue that they could actually mobilize people around. And the statutes that followed are far from perfect, and Congress is far from perfect. But that said, I think it's important here to note that part of what we ought to be thinking through is, do we need a statute here at the end of the day? I mean, we could agree maybe that probable cause is a reasonable standard for a lot of the cell tracking stuff, but guess what? A recent study just came out indicating there's total inconsistency in how local jurisdictions treat cell tracking data. Actually, I think the Hawaii Department of Public Safety uses probable cause, so rest easy. But I think those are the questions we should be asking ourselves.
Now, Tino, there's a statute pending in Congress, and it's a bipartisan statute. It's introduced by Josh Chaffetz of Utah and Ron Wyden of Oregon. It's a geolocational privacy bill that would require consent and a higher standard of cause and so forth. And you'd think it would pass because it's supported by civil libertarian liberals and libertarian Tea Party conservatives, but it's not going anywhere. President Obama has opposed it, as he has most privacy protections, except for those that have provoked digital activism, such as the SOPA and PIPA, the intellectual property debates that created activism on the web, led the administration to support privacy. Here it's opposed it. And basically, for the reasons you discussed in your initial comments, Tino, no moderate mainstream Democrats and Republicans don't want to be soft on crime. So it should be a statute, but it's pending and it's not going anywhere. What do we do?
Complain. I mean, I think this is not the first or the last time where a statute should pass and it doesn't pass. You know, food safety laws were not updated with respect to the FDA for 70 years. There were consequences that involved health issues, but there were also consequences that involved executive action. So I think, I guess I feel a little bit like the gentleman in the earlier panel who asked the question about market solutions. There may be some market failures and some political market failures, but I do think the question here ought to be partly, what is it that we are asking policymakers to do in a world where the Fourth Amendment doctrine that we have come to accept and that we now live with is not solving the problem? And
please,
Jeff, I wanted to say, I think Congress does have some significant institutional advantages in crafting privacy laws and new technologies. So Congress can do a couple things that courts can't. One, they can have a comprehensive answer. The other is they can have hearings into the technologies. They can update the statutes over time. And an interesting example is the Electronic Communications Privacy Act, which regulated the contents of internet communications in 1986, when most people were not familiar with the internet, and the few people that were capitalized the whole thing. So it was all internet in all caps. So this is long before the courts ever address these questions. We actually don't get decisions from the courts on Fourth Amendment implications of internet surveillance until really around 2006, 2007, we start to get some cases. And this is decades after the technology was around. So I'm not saying that sort of the Congress can do it all and we should magically just think Congress will solve every problem, but there are difficulties with courts trying to come up with answers. To my mind, what it means is courts should really wait until the technology stabilizes. And Marcia gave a good example of iPads and iPhones, where these are brand new technologies. And I think it's important for courts to wait until we know what the facts are, we know what the technology is, before creating a rule to try to regulate the new technology.
I agree with you and I disagree with you. You are correct, I think, that legislatures, as a general matter, may be in a better position to sort of nimbly react to some of these things and enact protections. But I think it's also worth noting that the Electronic Communications Privacy Act, which was passed in 1986, is in desperate need of an overhaul. Desperate need. And there are bills out there to do it, but they don't seem to be moving anywhere quickly. And as you mentioned, there's this GPS bill that's out there, and in the majority opinion in Jones, Justice Scalia basically begged Congress to pass a law on this, and it's sitting there and it's not moving anywhere. So I feel like at some point, if the legislature isn't going to step up to address the problem, it may be up to the courts to just do it. And you know, there have been times when the Supreme Court has made decisions that technology has advanced to a point where we need to adjust the way that we handle it under the Fourth Amendment. A really good example of that is wiretapping phone calls. It used to be the case that it was not a Fourth Amendment violation to wiretap a phone call under Olmstead versus the United States, which was decided in 1928. But by the time we got to Katz versus the United States in 1967, the Supreme Court changed its mind. And I think that cases need to be decided that can percolate up through the judicial system to give the Supreme Court the opportunity to make these calls. And in terms of the technology and waiting for it to stabilize, in theory, I think that makes sense, but as a practical matter, I don't think it does stabilize. I think that it continues to change and innovations continue to move forward, and as a general matter, that's wonderful for society. And we're able to take advantage of all the wonderful things that gives us. But if we're just going to wait for innovation just to stall, that point's never going to come.
But this is interesting, because in what you say, I think what I hear also is an underappreciated law enforcement interest in actually getting this clarified by statute. I mean, look at the Jones case. You can't always predict, if you're in law enforcement, exactly how this is going to be resolved by courts. Mm-hmm. So it's very difficult to get this legislation passed, but I do think that one kind of enlightened self-interest argument is to get these rules clarified so that people know what investigations are going to work.
So what does the constitutional rule look like? You're hearing this interesting debate about who should take the lead, legislatures or courts, what's feasible, and whether caution or judicial leadership is necessary. What does the doctrine look like in practice? So drones, it's now possible. I saw it driving on the highway with my kids last week to buy toy drones that you can use like model airplanes and do backflips and so forth. Very soon it'll be possible for individuals and the government to fly gnat-sized drones in the air and to track particular individuals from place to place, making it unnecessary for Google to put the cameras on open planet and just have individualized surveillance of everyone in the world. Let's assume there's no statute on the books. What's the constitutional argument against it? Is it just a Fourth Amendment argument? Is it an invasion of my persons or house or papers or effects? Or is it a violation of something else? The Europeans would call it dignity. They have a very extensive jurisprudence about how it's an indignity to be photographed in public and using the Google goggles that we heard about on the last panel, identify someone outside a bar, take a picture of them, plug their face into a face recognition database and post them on the internet. That would be a violation of European data privacy law if there was no scientific or journalistic need because of a strong sense that dignity was being invaded. In the American context, we might call it autonomy. Justice Kennedy, in his opinion, in Casey versus Planned Parenthood, talked about at the heart of liberty is the right to define your own conception of meaning, of the universe, the mystery of human life. Justice Scalia unkindly ridiculed that as the sweet mystery of life passage. But in fact, it's a very powerful, inspiring testament to the necessity of autonomy in public and private. It's also recognized in Lawrence, and that might be invoked against the drones. I want to ask each of you, does 24/7 drone surveillance violate the Constitution? And if so, what is the constitutional argument against it? Orin.
I think it's hard to generate the constitutional argument against it. I mean, you're mentioning European concepts of dignity, which are great if you're in Europe and you like the European concept of dignity, but you know, in U.S. law, if there's nothing prohibiting it, it's allowed. And so I ultimately think the drone question is going to be resolved by some sort of statutory protection or regulatory limits on the use of drones, because it's not that hard for people to say, hey, wait a minute, drones are spooky and they're odd and I don't like how they're going to be used, so we should regulate them. Whether it's done under, you know, noise ordinances or something else, I don't know, but I'm sure there will be public limitations. I just don't think they're going to be coming from the Constitution.
And just so I understand, do you feel the same about the open planet scenario? And you would think that that should be regulated by statute, but it's not a constitutional violation if the government tracks us 24/7 on Google?
Yeah, in the case of the open planet hypothetical, I get stuck on the state action problem. So it's a private company that's setting up the software that anyone can use, as I understand it. So I think that would be regulated by statute. It's not unconstitutional for the government to do what any individual can do. Usually if it's something that anyone can do, the government can do it as well, at least as a Fourth Amendment matter. Maybe you can start, you know, coming up with First Amendment issues or something like that, but that requires a stretch on current doctrine.
So your question reminds me a little bit of the closing part of Democracy and Distrust, the famous book on constitutional law that John Hart Ely wrote, and where he espouses a rather spare view in some respects of constitutional protections quite carefully and articulately. And in the end, he has this whole hypothetical about what if Congress passes a law that forces you to remove your spleen and, you know, you have some kind of generalized constitutional right against that. And he ends it by saying, it's not going to happen. And that's not just a way of fighting the hypothetical. It's a way of actually suggesting that the way the Constitution deals with this is through legislation and politics. I must say, though, that here, I actually think that there are some constitutional concerns. So you can look at this argument from the perspective of cats and what happens when you think hard about what a reasonable expectation of privacy means in this context. You can also, I mean, to pick up something that Orin briefly alluded to, there's not just a question of can the government gather the data, there's a question of what it can do with that data. And that then brings in the First Amendment, it brings in equal protection, because it raises the question of what consequence follows from the government's decision to use information that maybe that little drone gathered about what you said, about what you did?
It's hard, isn't it? Right now, we're at this dramatic moment. We have these great invasions, open planet, the drones. It's not clear that they violate the Constitution under existing doctrine. But if the Constitution doesn't apply, then citizens have less protection in the age of drones and of the internet than citizens did when the Fourth Amendment was founded and we were concerned about breaking into houses. That means, Marcia, that the weight of our liberties are on you. You give us the constitutional argument against the drugs.
Fix it. Well, that's the big question, right? How do you fix it? And does it require a change in the way that we apply the Fourth Amendment? The D.C. District Court, in an earlier phase of United States versus Jones, took a stab at this, which was, I think, quite controversial, and Orin has extensively written about how it wasn't a good idea to go in the direction they went in. The case at that point was called United States versus Maynard, if you're interested in looking this up. And the D.C. Circuit tried to make the argument that warrantless GPS tracking over a prolonged period of time implicates a privacy interest that is greater than the sum of its parts, basically. Did I say that right? Greater than the sum of its parts?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I just want to make sure that that made sense. Basically, that, you know, you might watch somebody's movements from point A to point B, and maybe they don't have any reasonable expectation of privacy in that. And then maybe they travel from point B to point C, and then maybe they don't have any reasonable expectation of privacy in that movement. But what if you watch them over the course of a month, everywhere they go over the course of a month, and then suddenly you learn all these things about them that you wouldn't know otherwise, like the doctors that they're visiting or the church that they go to, the associations they have, you know, the people who visit their homes. And you can learn a tremendous amount about a person that you wouldn't know otherwise. And the privacy interest in that, and sort of the greater sum of your life, all of the interactions that make up your day-to-day habits, is something that could be protected under the Fourth Amendment. And like I said, that's very controversial. Orin has a whole article about how unworkable this is. The Supreme Court did not go with that reasoning at the end of the day, but I think that both of the concurring opinions have language in them that kind of suggests that the justices agree that there could be something there some sort of a greater protectable interest that is deserving of Fourth Amendment protection. So that's one thing. Another thing is there's a professor out there named Susan Freewald who's come up with an interesting theory for how you might regulate law enforcement collection of information in cases like this. And what she suggested is that, you wouldn't look so much at the technology per se, but you would look at the surveillance technique. And you would consider four factors in deciding whether or not Fourth Amendment protection ought to apply. The first is the surveillance technique hidden? Does the subject of the surveillance know about it? If not, then that factor would weigh in favor of Fourth Amendment protection. The second factor is the surveillance intrusive? Is it intruding upon an activity that a person has an expectation of privacy in? The third one is it continuous? Is it something that's happening again and again and again? And then the fourth one is it indiscriminate? Is it targeting information that's actually even greater than just the information the government wants? And she suggests that you would consider all four of these factors and balancing them, you might decide that when the government uses this particular surveillance technique, then Fourth Amendment protection might apply in that situation.
That's extremely helpful in practical terms, and I want to sum up and reiterate. The Freewald proposal is very useful. Along those lines, Professor Slobogan of Vanderbilt has come up with a similar suggestion that courts should balance the intrusiveness of the search against the likelihood that it is to produce evidence and the seriousness of the crime, as well as its effectiveness. And he said that courts in the 18th century used to do this, balancing the intrusiveness of the search against the seriousness of the crime. You could search desk drawers when you're looking for murder, but not for seditious libel, for example, and you had to make sure that it was effective and not indiscriminate. So these sort of factors, again, Canadian courts, European courts are more comfortable weighing, but they used to be engaged in by juries, and that's helpful. And then you note Judge Ginsburg's wonderful opinion in Maynard, and the fact that it doesn't seem to depend on what people's actual expectations are, but the notion that we have a objective expectation that a whole lot of our lives won't be revealed regardless of whether we're told about it. In this context, and moving to the next topic, I can't help but mention Judge Kaczynski's wonderful opinion in the Ninth Circuit version of the GPS surveillance, which was both remarkably compelling in its reminder about the dangers of living in a society that doesn't respect privacy, and also, like Judge Ginsburg's opinion, represented a willingness to translate the Constitution in light of new technologies that wasn't just dependent on what the framers thought or on unlimited policy considerations, but trying to preserve the same amount of privacy in the 21st century that the framers took for granted. I think it's a really wonderful model for how to address these issues. Speaking about computer searches and border searches, which Judge Kaczynski and others have also written thoughtfully about, we're having a dramatic debate in this country right now about what the appropriate limitations on the searches of computers at the border and elsewhere are. In the CDT decision, the Ninth Circuit imposed some limits. Judge Kaczynski suggested some others. I want to ask each of you, I'll start with Orin, who can give us the state of the law so well. What is the state of the law about what limits magistrates can impose on computer searches, and what are the undecided issues that the courts are debating?
Okay, so there are a couple different issues, and I think it's important to separate them. One of them is an issue that, Jeff, you just flagged, which is to what extent can magistrate judges impose limits on how warrants are executed when the warrant includes the search and seizure of a computer? So that's one issue. And then the border search issue is another issue, and that is to what extent can the government search computers at the border? And there are a bunch of circuits that are dealing with this question mostly at the same time. And so let me focus on the first one. And that is this question of if you are a magistrate judge and the government comes to you with an application for a search warrant and you're worried that the government is going to execute the warrant in a way that might be overbroad, to what extent do you have the power to impose limitations on what the government can do in executing that search? And to what extent, where do you get those limitations and are those limitations enforceable? And so this is an issue that brings up the comprehensive drug testing case that Jeff mentioned, where the Ninth Circuit was grappling with these questions, for the most part endorsed at least the idea of magistrate judges imposing limitations. To my mind, I think that the Supreme Court doctrine is to the contrary in a case United States versus Grubbs from 2006, which reversed a Ninth Circuit decision allowing limitations on warrants in the case of conditional warrants. I think the Supreme Court doctrine is relatively clear that the magistrate judge's job is just to look for probable cause, check for particularity of the place to be searched and the item or things to be seized, and that's it, sort of comply with the federal rules of criminal procedure and the Fourth Amendment. And this question of what the rules are in the execution of the warrant is something that's left for ex post review. At the same time, right now, the case law is really sparse on this question. There's a case pending directly addressing this question. It was directly fully litigated in the Supreme Court of Vermont that has been pending for, I think, 15 months. They haven't issued an opinion yet. So I'm kind of hopeful that there's a law clerk transition in there soon that means that they have to get it out before the new law clerks come in. But that's the only case where it's really directly addressed. It was sort of assumed that magistrate judges had this power in the comprehensive drug testing case, and as those of you that are magistrate judges know, that this is an issue that has really gotten the attention of the Justice Department because this question of where do the limitations come from, what are the limits of that authority, if there is such an authority, is tremendously relevant to any warrant that involves the search and seizure of computers, and that's a tremendous number of cases. And more warrants for applications are ending up being computer warrant applications. So it's a pressing issue, and right now just not a lot of case law either way.
So Orin has described things so well, of course. Marcia, does this make sense? I mean, that the existing law says that my iPhone, in which I hold far more personal information than the critics of King George ever could have hidden in their desk drawers, is no different than a suitcase, and if there's probable cause to look for one thing, then you can search my entire life, and if it doesn't make sense, what should the Fourth Amendment say?
Right, you know, this is one of these things that my organization has been particularly concerned about. At this point, I think in the border search context, the courts are pretty unanimous in the decision that there is no real meaningful Fourth Amendment protection at the border. And if you take an electronic device across the border, border agents have free rein to sort through the data on there and make copies of it. And there is no level of suspicion whatsoever needed to do that, which a lot of people, when they learn this, they tend to be really, really shocked, because I think that people think of their laptop computers and their phones as one of the most intimate possessions that they have. I mean, there's a tremendous amount of data on these devices, everything from proprietary information to, you know, in my case, attorney-client privileged information. People can have years of correspondence with their family and their friends and their coworkers on their computers. You can have financial data, medical records on your computers, and the idea that there would be no protection for that kind of data at a place like the border, I think a lot of people find on a gut level very concerning. And many of the opinions that have looked at this question have basically said, well, listen, at the border, it's well established that border agents can look through your possessions. And I think historically that's true, but people haven't always been bringing objects with this amount of data across the border. And you know, while the courts don't believe at this point that there's any special protection needed for that data, I think it's worth thinking about whether that's something that might be useful and valuable. And there was a time when there were congressional proposals out there that would have required reasonable suspicion to search devices at the border. Those proposals haven't gone anywhere. And so that's the state of the law at this point.
I don't have much to add to that except to make one small observation, which is that certainly there's a version of the technological future where devices do become a little bit more like netbooks. People have lost lots of fortunes overestimating how much people would end up using netbooks, but the number of you using iPads just is thought-provoking, because you can imagine one architecture for a device, which is that what you get in the device is literally only the necessary information to display on the screen or pipe through the headphones, the last little bit that you actually want to hear and interact with, and everything else is in the so-called cloud. Mm-hmm. And in that sort of world, this set of doctrine will become less and less important over time, and will become more important, again, to come back to a theme that I've mentioned several times, is the statutory stuff. So the Electronic Communications Privacy Act, which you think, Marcia, desperately is in need of being updated. And then the question really is, how do you deal with these questions about whether it's over 180 days old or not, and who gets access to that information?
And of course, the third-party doctrine will become more important, too.
Indeed.
Yeah, I think it's important, too, to just focus. There are two different issues, and it's easy to blend them together and important to keep them apart. One of the issues that we're talking about is, what are the rules for the government to access the information? And then another question is, what are the use restrictions on that information? So for example, the courts could say there's a wide range of access rights. The government can get the information at the border, but there could be use restrictions. And the doctrinal hook for that would be limiting the plain view exception in the computer context. I tend to think that that's the more sensible way to go, is sort of say that the real difference between computer searches and physical searches is that there's so much information on computers that and the forensic process is so invasive of computers that the searches of computers are more invasive than physical searches, and the concern with information outside of the scope of a warrant or outside of the scope of the cause of the government search coming into the government's possession is so much greater in the digital setting than in the physical setting. So I think it's just important to keep the access and use question separate.
Let me just sum up some of these points because they're so important. Orin has eloquently argued for use restrictions rather than restrictions on collection as one of the great protections for privacy. And indeed, the Europeans have adopted his model. The Germans allow their intelligence service broad access to warrantless data, but it can only be passed on to law enforcement if there's evidence of terrorism or serious crimes. If they find evidence of civil offenses or adultery or so forth, the information cannot be shared. There is a use restriction. Tino says that whether the iPhone is a container or a file cabinet matters less when all of our documents are stored in the digital cloud that is distributed third-party servers owned by Google and Yahoo. But that, as Marcia suggests, makes it even more important to reconsider the third-party doctrine, which might hold that if I store my information with Google, I've abandoned all expectation of privacy in it, and it can be shared with the government at will. Ladies and gentlemen, like a good dinner party, we have lots more to discuss, but time is getting short, and I am eager to hear your questions, so let me invite you to the microphone to ask questions of our panelists. I thank you so much, sir, for making the long journey in full view of your colleagues, underneath a very, it's under the camera, I thought it was a statue of some kind of heroic winged victory, but welcome, sir.
I'm Rick Creator, a magistrate judge from Tacoma, Washington. When the Fourth Amendment was adopted during its first 200 years of its interpretation, we were talking about situations in which the government would be allowed to conduct searches that would not otherwise be available to the public. For instance, you need probable cause of criminal activity to authorize a search of a home. That home would be protected from private invasion from common law rules of trespass. Now we're talking about a world in which data is available and the technology is developing at a very quick pace, and private individuals can legally collect information that far exceeds what the government may be interested in seeing. My question is, are we now trying to formulate procedures to protect individuals from the government where the government's right to investigate may not be coextensive with the private right to gather information which is perfectly legal?
Such an important question. Orin.
I don't think so, in part because if you say that the government can't do something that the private sector can do, there's always going to be some workaround. The private sector is going to get the information. The government's going to find some way of getting it eventually. Yeah, I think what we're dealing with more is, in the case of, say, network information, rules saying that certain information which has been disclosed to the network owner is protected generally. It's protected, and the privacy laws protect against access not only from the government but also from private parties. There's some ways in which the laws are treating private parties and the government differently, but the general idea is that that data is protected against both the government and private parties. And it's a very important difference between how the Fourth Amendment works and how the statutes work. The statutes are protecting generally against both private and public access. There are certainly different sets of rules. So for example, the government can obtain a search warrant to gain access to the private information, and a private party, of course, can't. But generally speaking, the laws here are retaining the general idea that if information is available to the public, it's also available to the government.
And Marcia, should that be the case? Is there an argument to be made that now that the government has so much more power to invade than the constable of the 18th century did, that the government should not be able to piggyback on the private sector and should be restricted in ways that Google is not?
Well, I think absolutely. And this is one of the reasons why the third party doctrine questions loom so large. I worry that the Twitter opinion that I mentioned earlier basically endorses this idea that if the service provider is able to collect this information, then you know the government can sort of just slip into the service provider's shoes and do whatever with that information that the service provider might have done with it. The idea being that if you are aware that you're giving information to the service provider, then you know you shouldn't have any expectation of privacy that the government shouldn't get that information. But I think it's a far more nuanced question. Your understanding is that you're giving the service provider information and that the service provider will do certain things with it. That may or may not include giving it to the government without a warrant. And I think that's a separate question, and I think that that's a nuance that ought to be taken into account.
Yes, sir.
Yes, David Stern, a lawyer from Los Angeles. What is the status with respect to encrypted information? So that if you encrypt things either in the cloud or on your personal device, at the border or someplace, what is the status with respect to case law developments and the like on that issue?
I can take this one. So there have been several cases in the last few years, and in two cases just in the past few months, dealing with the question of encrypted information and whether law enforcement whether the government can force people to decrypt that information, whether that violates the Fifth Amendment privilege against self-incrimination. I think it's pretty well established that if law enforcement has valid legal process, they can seize a computer, and if it has encrypted information on it, if they're able to break that encryption themselves, then it's fair game. But there are big legal questions about whether if they are unable to decrypt that information on their own, can they force the person who they seize the computer from to either provide a password so that they can decrypt it, or force that person to type in a password and produce a decrypted version of the information. And there have been a couple of interesting opinions that clarify the scope of this just in the past few months. And the rule that has emerged is basically that if it is a foregone conclusion, okay, so first of all, as a general matter, an individual can have a reasonable, I want to say reasonable expectation of privacy, but that's not what I'm looking for. A person can have a valid Fifth Amendment right against self-incrimination that can prevent the government from forcing them to provide a password or type information in and provide information that might be incriminating, all right? However, if there is, if it is already a foregone conclusion that that there is incriminating information on there and law enforcement has a good idea of what it is and where it's going to be found, then at that point it's really just a matter of surrendering data that already exists, and there's no testimonial aspect to that act of production at that point. And so obviously it's a very fact-specific question that is very particular to the case, but I think the rule suggests that as a general matter, if law enforcement is trying to compel somebody to turn over this information and it's basically just a fishing expedition, then that is something that would be protected by the Fifth Amendment. But if it's a situation where law enforcement has a really good sense of what the evidence looks like and where it's going to be, particularly on this computer, then at that point, turning over the information isn't going to reveal anything that would be testimonial.
And I would just add, Jeff has stressed the ways in which the Fourth Amendment may not be covering as much as it used to at the time of the framers. This is a context in which the Constitution is doing far more than it did at the time of the framers. So we could have the government need to get a search warrant to search the computer the government comes across encrypted information and then can't decrypt it, sort of a lockable safe that can't be picked open. In the traditional sort of physical setting, it's just a question of breaking open the safe, or it's just a physical problem, not a legal problem. Now with the introduction of encryption and widespread encryption, free programs like TrueCrypt that make it very difficult for the government to even know that encryption has been used, it actually is much easier for individuals that know the technology to hide information and much harder for the government to get the information relative to, say, the starting point of 1789 or something like that. So the technology kind of works both ways. Sometimes it gives the government more power, and sometimes it gives the government less power than the baseline.
Well, I see Judge Bybee waiting in the wings, so I think I just want to sum up briefly by saying that this has been a vigorous discussion, just as lively as I hoped, in which you've seen respectful but plausible disagreement about who should take the lead in protecting constitutional values in an age of new technologies. Should it be legislatures? Should it be the courts? Should it be political activism? That's a healthy debate to have. But what I just want to urge on all of you who are judges is not to avoid these questions by assuming that technology will take care of them, or that there's anything inevitable about the future of our constitutional values. I just want to commend the words of my hero in these privacy issues, Justice Louis Brandeis, the most far-seeing theorist of protecting constitutional values in the age of new technologies. And Brandeis insisted, if we would guide by the light of reason, we must let our minds be bold. Please join me in thanking our panelists.